Welcome to your miracle moment. You're watching The Miracle Report, and we're here with a powerful testimony with our dear mom, Sister Marie Claude. And she was healed from arthritis and from heart palpitations. So will you tell us first that you've been suffering with this for a very long time, about 14 years.
14 years, yes, I have.
So, where was the arthritis?
If you can look at my fingers, it's going a bit on the crooked side, and I get a lot of pains with it. So far, you can feel the pain healing. It's not that, what's the name? And my palpitation is into the river, peace and quiet. I feel very well.
So this past week, before you came to tonight's service, you were suffering with heart palpitations.
For a whole week, that I can even have a friend to vouch for that as well.
And as well, and the arthritis, was it paining this week or earlier?
I have that all the time. It's been always painful. I feel better, I do. I felt a different when I went onto the stage, and when my friend also put her hands on me, and when Pastor put his hands on me, I could feel, even now I can have, I've got goosebumps all over me.
Right, come, walk with me again, come on. Let's walk more faster now. Let's do some real pumping that blood. Let's pump it. Let's pump it, come on, let's go. You're gonna have, you've already got new blood. You've got new blood. Come here. Lay hands on the heart right now. Wow. What happened? Tell them what just happened to our heart.
Pining.
Stop burning?
Pining.
Pounding.
It's not pounding. Are you sure?
No.
Feel it hard. Press it. Maybe it's pounding. There's hiding somewhere, the pounds.
No. It's not.
Can you share with us one last thing? How did our ministry just impact you? I know it's your second time with us.
It's that you speak the truth. There's no hidden danger. There's nothing. This is what I say. That's what I mean. That's it. Because I have been looking for a church for a few years now. And everything was just... Now I'm happy. I've been fed with the Word of God.
Amen.
It's not I, me, me. It's they preach the Word of God. They take the words from the Bible, from the Word of God. Everything is about God. That's the way I see it.
Amen. So we're going to encourage you to come and join us at the Miracle Center. And you can find out more info on our website. You can just visit sivamodley.com and you can see our YouTube channel from there and see our amazing playlists, watch more amazing miracles, healing, see all our episodes, and also join our global church. So go and explore our website and stay tuned and get ready for a powerful word.
Welcome back to the program. Wow, we are talking about the Holy Spirit. What a time we are having here. I've been sharing about how the Holy Spirit operates, why it's important to know Him, how I met Him, my encounters, how the presence of God, the anointing, the relationship with the Holy Spirit has steadily been increasing. I've been sharing about hunger. I've been sharing about the Trinity. So if you missed any of the episodes, go to my YouTube channel. On YouTube, you can subscribe. You can watch all the episodes you missed for free. Tell your friends about it. Tell your neighbors, people that need a miracle, people that need a breakthrough, people that need this message. Tell them to watch Your Miracle Moment and tell them that, hey, there's various platforms to watch this program. The YouTube channel is updated live. It's not, you know, like we have this episode and you have to 2 weeks time, then only you'll see the episode. No, it comes on shortly after it's broadcast. And also visit our website, sivamodley.com. From our website, you see our Facebook page, you see our Twitter, our Instagram, and you can contact us on all the different social media platforms. If you have a prayer request, go online to our website and fill in the prayer request, or you can email your prayer request to prayer@sivamodley.com. It comes to me, it comes to my prayer team, and we always pray. There are so many thousands of people that send prayer requests. Literally thousands that send prayer requests. We may not personally reply to every single prayer request, but if you've sent it, we are praying for it. There is a reply email that you get, a reply message that we received it. So you know we received it, you know we're praying for you. And when you get your breakthrough, when you get your miracle, please tell us about it. Send us your testimony report. We love to hear testimonies. It builds up people's faith that watch our program. It builds up our faith. It builds up our church and those that are desperate for a miracle. You never know, there may be someone out there that's going through what you are going through. And when you share your testimony, they get encouraged and they have their breakthrough. And this is what we are. Jesus said we are to teach everyone the gospel. And that's what it means to be a believer in Christ. A believer in Christ is not just somebody who goes to church. It's someone who influences the world. We are the salt of the world and we call to reach the earth, the ends of the earth, with the good news of Jesus Christ. Teaching them and to become disciples of Jesus Christ, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And that's what we do with our TV program. Our TV program goes globally, goes all over the world. And even our global church, which is our online church, has members all over the world. We have members in the Middle East. We have members in Asia. We have members all over Europe, America, all over Africa. They are part of our global church. You can also become part of it if you don't have a local church. You want to be part of the teachings that we do here. You can log on, sign on for free, be part of the global church. You can become a member of the global church, fill in a membership form online. And just now we are bringing courses online for you to do. And you can also do courses for free online. And you can sew online. There's so many things that you can do as part of the global church. Also remember that there are buses that run now from various places in Gauteng to our church. And you should contact our offices if you want to find out more about the various transport. It's part of our outreach to reach the lost. We want to see people empowered with the power of the Holy Spirit, with the revelation of God's word, and lives and destinies changed. So let's get on with what we spoke about yesterday. We said that the Holy Spirit has a mind, that he, and this is from Romans 8:27, that he has a mind. And if he has a mind, he has a will, that he makes decisions on his own. But the decisions he makes is in harmony with the Trinity. It's not outside. He doesn't speak on his own. It's in harmony with the Trinity. However, he makes personal decisions. For example, in 1 Corinthians 12:11, as we studied yesterday, he decides what gifts you should have. The Holy Spirit decides what gifts you should have. If you ask him, he will give you all the gifts that you need. Amen. So he has a mind, he has a will. He makes decisions. He's not a puppet. He's like Jesus. He's like the Father. He is God. He has a mind. He has a will. You can worship him. You can talk to him. We fellowship with him. He can also grieve. He can also get hurt. Look at this, Isaiah 63, verse 10. Yet they rebelled and grieved his Holy Spirit. So he turned and became their enemy. God the Father became an enemy of the people because they grieved his Holy Spirit. And he himself, look at the way the scripture emphasizes this. God the Father personally fought against them. Wow. It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. And so God the Father went after them, because they messed with the Holy Spirit. I shared in the previous episode about the relationship between God the Father and the Holy Spirit. There is this bond. There is this extreme close bond between God the Father and God the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is so special to the Father. There is such a love relationship that the Father didn't just want to let him go. Because we read that while Jesus was on earth, he had to petition the Father. He had to make his case to the Father to send the Holy Spirit. He didn't say, "Light, my time is up. Okay, Dad, send the Holy Spirit." He didn't do that. He had to petition. He had to spend time in prayer. He had to spend time requesting, convincing the Father that we need the counselor, The earth needs the Comforter. The earth needs the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Truth. And the Father, therefore, because of the petitions made by Jesus, released the Holy Spirit to the earth. Now, if Jesus Christ himself did not petition the Father, I'm not sure, and I say this, you know, I'm under correction, but I say this, I'm not sure if the Holy Spirit would have come to the earth, because I'm not sure if God the Father would have wanted to release the Holy Spirit. Jesus had to petition the Father. Because he petitioned the Father, he pleaded with the Father, he made his case to the Father. The Father said, okay, I love my people on the earth so much. I will do this thing. It's not something I want to do. It's something that's difficult for me to do. But I will send the Holy Spirit. Now, that tells me there's a very close relationship. You know, you can talk against the Father, and you know, and something's going to happen to you. The Father will get angry. You can talk against Jesus. You'll get rebuked. But dare you talk against the Holy Spirit. It's not just the Holy Spirit that gets grieved. God the Father also gets grieved. You never heard that before. Let me say it again. When you grieve the Holy Spirit, God the Father also gets grieved. Here's it right here, Isaiah 63:10. Because they grieved the Holy Spirit, God the Father became the enemy, and he fought against them. Look at the way he'd affected the Father. He'd affected the Father so much. It affected God the Father so much, the way they trampled on the Holy Spirit, that he was grieved. He became upset and he took them on. So what is the point here? The point is, don't grieve the Holy Spirit. But Pastor, how do we grieve the Holy Spirit? Well, when the Holy Spirit comes upon a person, the Bible says you become a different man. You change. And every time the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you start to change. You may change slowly, and sometimes you may resist a little bit of change. And you know, and then God has to work on you. Maybe God might say, hey, you know, Betty is not the one. I hope no one's called Betty out there. I'm just giving an example. Betty is not the one for you. I've got Suzanne for you. She's the one I want you to marry. And you say, no, but I love Betty. I don't want to break up with Betty. And then the Holy Spirit goes away. He comes back again and says, Betty's not the one. Suzanne is the one. You say, no, I don't want to listen to you. I want Betty. And then after a while, you come to the spot, you say, okay, God, I surrender. I will let go of Betty. Whatever your will is, let your will be done. And so you can fight with God over certain things and maybe delay the little change along the way. That's part of our growing process. That will not grieve the Holy Spirit. It might disappoint him, but not really grieve him. What grieves the Holy Spirit is when you resist change. You resist change. Let's say you go to church and the Holy Spirit comes upon you and you say, I am not going to make a fool of myself. I am not going to fall down. Now, falling down is not important. Let me say this first. It's not important to fall down. You know, we make such a story about it, but it's not important to fall down. But you can resist the Holy Spirit. You can say, listen, I don't want his power to touch me. And every time you go in his presence, don't touch me, God. Don't touch me, God. I don't want to get drunk. I don't want to make a spectacle of myself. I don't want to lift my hands and worship God, because this is my culture to fold my arms in church. My father used to do it. My grandfather used to do it. So this is our culture. You could twist the scripture. I'm just like Jesus. He's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He doesn't change. Me too. I don't change. You could twist that scripture, you know, and say, I refuse to change. So you could go to church and you can refuse for God to touch your life. And as I said to you, there's sometimes when there's certain things that you want and you want to negotiate with God and you don't really want to surrender right now, that's different. I'm talking about people that really oppose the Holy Spirit. There's a word for those people. The Bible calls them stiff-necked. Stiff-necked, watch this, stiff-necked. They don't go that way. They're stiff-necked. So the Bible says that when you are stiff-necked, you oppose the Holy Spirit. And when you're a stiff-necked Christian, or it's a stiff-necked church, they grieve the Holy Spirit. They grieve the Holy Spirit. And in that environment, the Holy Spirit doesn't dwell long in that environment. You know, even when it comes to worship, There is songs that people sing because they like the songs. But if you sing songs that you like, it doesn't really favor the Holy Spirit. He can get grieved in that environment because he wants you to sing a certain song because the worship is for him. So if the worship is for him, he wants to make a special request. Sing that song and worship me with that song. And then worship me with that song. So he wants to make a special request. But if you decide, no, I've got my list of songs. I'm only going to sing what I want to sing. If you do that, then you actually grieve the Holy Spirit. You grieve him. What about preaching? Sometimes God can give you a message, deep revelation. You spend the whole week preparing the message, fasting, praying. You come on Sunday morning, you're pregnant with the word, you're ready to deliver. And I've seen sometimes people grieve the Holy Spirit this way. I had someone that came to my church, and the Holy Spirit decided to move. And he didn't want preaching, he wanted to touch his people at that moment. Now, when that happens to me, even though I spent the whole week preparing the message, I just close my book. I just close my iPad. I say, right, let's go for it. What is it you want to do, Holy Spirit? And it's kind of a way he tests me to see, will I grieve him? Am I stiff-necked or will I surrender? But I've seen someone that actually ministered my church but guess what? The moment this person started preaching, he left the building. Why? Because on that day, he wanted his will to be done. It's better to obey. Amen? Now, listen to me. When you have your own agenda, you have your own set times, and God says, give me a little bit more, and you say, I'm not ready to give you a little bit more, you grieve the Holy Spirit. That's what it means to grieve. You see, we think grieving the Holy Spirit is when somebody speaks against someone with the Holy Spirit. It's not just that. I mean, you can see somebody drunk in the Spirit and say, well, I think that's a devil on them. That's actually grieving the Holy Spirit. If you don't know better, keep quiet. Keep quiet. You know, I'd rather hold your mouth and say, God, give me revelation. Give me discernment. Is this demonic? And if you're still not sure, keep quiet. If you see that person manifesting and somebody's casting on a devil, I was right. But if you're not sure, don't comment, because you can end up grieving the Holy Spirit by what you say against him. And, you know, the people said, they grieved the Holy Spirit. The people said to Jesus, Jesus has a demon on him. And Jesus said, you're grieving the Holy Spirit because I've got the Holy Spirit inside me. And Satan can't cast out Satan. His kingdom will be upside down if he does that. Rather not say anything, because you can grieve the Holy Spirit. But there's other ways to grieve the Holy Spirit. It's when you are stiff-necked, when you don't want to change, and God keeps telling you, and you don't want to change. He keeps telling you, and you don't want to change. He keeps telling you to do something, and you don't want to do it. Eventually, that starts to grieve the Holy Spirit. Every time you hurt the Holy Spirit, he goes away. Do you want to be around someone that keeps hurting you? Do you want to be around someone that keeps putting you down? No, you don't want to be around that person. You want to be around people that keep uplifting you, people that keep speaking about your name and praising you. You want to be around those people. But people that hurt you, you don't want to be around them. The Holy Spirit does not want to be around Christians, does not want to be around churches that hurt him all the time. I got to say this. He doesn't want to be around people that hurt him all the time. I've been in conferences where the Holy Spirit got up and left the building because the preacher came on and grieved the Holy Spirit, or the worship team grieved the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit left, they didn't even know he left. I just got up and left myself, because then I'm listening to somebody giving me the head knowledge. I don't want someone's head knowledge. I want to get manna from heaven. I want to hear what God has to say. So the Holy Spirit must never be grieved in our churches. We grieve him in so many ways. We grieve him by gossiping. Gossiping is the worst form of grief. If you are around gossipers, you are around people that are crucifying the Holy Spirit. That's what they do. And don't you dare join gossipers. Run from them. Do what Joseph did when Potiphar's wife came after him. He ran. When you meet gossipers, treat them like Potiphar's wife. Run from them. Run from them. Because those are people that grieve the Holy Spirit. There's no blessing when you meet a gossiper. Really, there's no blessing when you meet a gossiper. There's no blessing when people are judgmental. There's no blessing when people don't want the Holy Spirit in their meeting. He's grieved in that environment. There's no blessing when we have a program and we lock out the Holy Spirit. There's no blessing in that. There are so many things that happens that grieves the Holy Spirit. That literally grieves the Holy Spirit. And sin grieves the Holy Spirit. When there's sin in the house and no one wants to deal with that sin, that grieves the Holy Spirit. Grieves the Holy Spirit. If people undermine the pastor of the church, they undermine the leadership of the church, they undermine other believers, that grieves the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit leaves that environment, leaves those people's fellowship. Why? Because they are grieving God's anointed. Now, we're not called to judge. We're called to bless. We're called to pray for. And if someone does something wrong, we pray for them. But we don't gossip about it. We ask God to intervene, for God to restore that person. And if that person is not willing to be restored, then guess what? God will remove the person. But we are not the ones called to be the judge and jury in the house of God. We're not called to say, hey, that sister there sang in the flesh. How do you know she sang in the flesh? How do you know that? We are not called to judge anything in the house of God. We are there to have an encounter with God. There to have an encounter with God. That's what we go to church for. And that's how church should be run. Churches should invite the Holy Spirit. Now, when you invite the Holy Spirit, what does that mean? It means you have to change the structure of your church. Listen to me. Maybe there's a pastor watching this broadcast. You have to change the structure of your church to accommodate the Holy Spirit. Let me say it again. If you want to welcome the Holy Spirit, the structure of your church has to change to welcome Him. Now, let me give you a simple example. Let's just say, you say, Pastor Siva, we would love for you to come and have lunch with us. And when I come to your home, you're busy watching maybe the Rugby World Cup or some soapy or whatever on TV, you're watching the news and you're glued to the news. And you open the door, you say, come and have a seat. I come and have a seat, but you're glued to the TV. And I say, hello, how are you guys? We okay. But you glued to the TV. Or you're sitting on your cell phone. You're talking to somebody in your cell phone while I'm there in your house. Now, how do you think I feel? I don't feel welcome that you really wanted me to be there. It seems like you're just waiting for the visit to be over. That's the way I feel. Let's just say on another case, you invite me to your house, and before you invite me to the house, you get the finest china, you take out those expensive dishes, and you get the best meals, you lay the table out. You're so excited. The moment I come through the door, everybody's hugging me, everybody's talking to me. Maybe I can't even get a word in because everybody's so excited. And they're sharing their experiences, sharing how much they love me, and then they're spoiling me. Maybe they might buy me gifts. Maybe they might have this dinner for me or lunch for me, whatever they invited me to. The best meal I could have, they treat me like royalty. In that home, I know I was appreciated. In that home, I know they love me. And guess what? If they say to me, will you please come back? Definitely I will go back. Definitely I'll go back. Why? Because of the love I received, the welcome I received in that home. But in the first home, I didn't receive welcome. I was just there as part of the furniture or just there as part of just a guest. But I wasn't really the VIP. I wasn't really important to the family. I wouldn't want to go back to that home again. If they say, come back again, I say, no. You know, your TV is more important. Your newspaper is more important. Your cell phone is more important. Your social media is more important. So I'm not welcome in that home, even though I've been invited. So some churches are just like that. They say, come, Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit comes. But guess what? When He turns up, it's not about Him. They've got their own agenda. They're watching their own program. They're doing their own stuff. They're preaching their own message. They're singing their own songs. They're doing their own teachings. They're running their own scene there. They've got their own order in place. There's chaos in that environment maybe sometimes. But they're doing everything that makes people like that church. Yet, the Holy Spirit is ignored. In that environment, he won't come back to that church. He won't come back because he was not honored. So anybody can say, we welcome you, Holy Spirit, but does he come? How do I know he comes? You know he comes because there is change in the lives of the people in that church. They grow closer to God. There's miracles taking place. There's transformations in marriages, in families, in homes. People are growing with Christ. But if there is no Holy Spirit, if the church has grieved him, beloved, then he's not there. He's not there. And I don't want to be in an environment where people grieve the Holy Spirit because he's my best friend. It's like this. Would you take your spouse, your wife or your husband to a function and the people don't want to talk to him, the people grieve him, the people gossip about him or they just ignore him? Would you take your spouse to that meeting? No, you won't, because your spouse is part of you. Two have become one flesh. You don't want someone to grieve the person that you love. So therefore, you will not go to that function. I will not go into an environment where people grieve the Holy Spirit. I'm sorry, I will not do it because I love him so much. He's my best friend. And I want him to become your best friend. I want you to know him intimately. So tomorrow on the program, I'm going to teach more of the word, and then I'm going to pray that you have an encounter with the Holy Spirit. So be prepared, get ready, spend some time fasting and praying, spend some time in worship, because tomorrow we're going to have an encounter with the Holy Spirit right there in your home. God bless you. I'll see you tomorrow on Your Miracle Moment.